Imagine the scenario with me for a minute. You decide that you are going to start a new project. Name that whatever it may be. Start a business, lose weight, whatever the case may be. And you sit on the computer and you're really excited because you're about to research how to do this thing. And you type in how to start a business. All of a sudden, 20,000 million searches come up. And you start looking at post after post, article after article, entry after entry, website after website, coach after coach, and your head just starts getting fuller and fuller and fuller of all this information until finally you feel like you are about to explode. And then you get into the space of overwhelm, and you get into the space of confusion and of feeling like you're never going to get past the research stage because now you're overloaded and you have no clue how to sort through all that information and how to make it work. Well, I believe that the industry in general, right, the experts and the gurus out there, we have done people a disservice when we're talking about mindset. And the reason I believe that is because I feel we've done with the idea of working on your mindset and getting your mindset right and making sure your mindset is in check. We've done the same thing as the picture that I just painted you. You start thinking about my mindset, and I know I need to work on my mindset, and all of a sudden you're overloaded and overwhelmed by all the different things out there, all the information out there. And I believe we make the mistake of thinking that we need to look at mindset as this big thing, when in reality, if we can break it down, like I was finally able to do in order to lose weight, right? Like to lose weight, what I had to do was break it down and think, okay, if I am going to eventually get this result of losing weight, what is it that I need to focus on? Where do I need to place my energy, my time, and my effort? And I realized that if I looked at what I'm eating, how much I'm moving, and how I saw myself, that I could lose all this weight and keep it off. And once I realized that and I started working on those three things, then I got to a space where I could lose the weight and keep it off. So what I would love to do today is walk us through, get this big idea of mindset. How do we break it down? Not just so that we are focusing on just two or three main things that we need to look at, but also so that we can take it out of the ethereal, out of up there somewhere, thinking that mindset is this woo-woo or this magical thing that you need to work on in a different plane, and bring it to earth, make it manageable, make it tangible, make it actionable, and make it work for you and for me. How's that sound? So stick around, because in this episode of Sincerely Speaking, we're going to demystify mindset and tell you what to focus on in order to make it work. Okay, so if you're anything like me, and I believe you are because you're sticking around here, then you've probably encountered this situation in your life where you are starting something, you're making progress, you're moving forward, but then all of a sudden you start questioning, who on earth do you think you are? Why would anybody listen to you? What makes you think that what you have to say is meaningful enough for people to pay attention to you, let alone pay you? Have you had that experience? So when I was going through all these processes, I developed a tool that helped me put on paper and see right in front of me all my worth, all my value, all the resources I actually had at my disposal. And it helped me move out of this stage or this feeling of scarcity and not enough and of you're never going to make it and who do you think you are, and move into a space of I have a plan. I know what I'm doing next, and I can take action on this thing. If that sounds like something that might be helpful to you, I'd love to give it to you for free. So here's what you get to do. Go to Instagram and look for me at marcy.amaro. Follow me and send me a DM so that I can send you the link to access the crops inventory, which is that tool that will help you move out of a mindset of scarcity and not enough and I can't do this and who do I think I am, and move you into a space of yes. Not only am I worth it, but I can actually do this, and here's the plan. So if you want to move out of doubt and into action, go ahead, find me on Instagram at marcy.amaro and send me a DM with the word crops, and I will send you the inventory your way. So we all know at this point, like if you asked people 10 years ago, even maybe even 6 or 7 years ago, if they needed to work on their mindset or what that even meant, most people would not have known what to say. Most people were not aware that mindset was even a thing, that you could work on it, that you could do something about it. But nowadays, most everybody, especially if you're in any kind of business setting, we are aware that mindset is not only a thing, but it's a really important thing in order to move forward. The problem is that for most of the time that people have been talking about mindset and mindfulness and all these things that have to do with it, they've done one of two things. They've either made it really ethereal, like almost otherworldly, like we are operating on the spiritual plane only. And you know that I'm a Christian, so you know that I believe in the spiritual and I believe it's important. But it's so hard to translate all of that into, okay, so what exactly am I supposed to do now? Right? So they tell you, okay, so exercise mindfulness, go ahead and be reflective, be mindful of everything that you're doing. But how do you do that? Right? So it becomes this untouchable thing almost that it's hard to pinpoint and know what to do about it. Right? Or the other thing they do is they tell you, okay, these are the elements to mindfulness, or these are the elements to work on your mindset. And this is what you get to do, but nobody tells you how to do it. So either way, you end up with this feeling of, okay, I need to do X, Y, or Z. If I don't do X, Y, or Z, there's no way I'm going to move forward, but how on earth do I do X, Y, and Z? So what I want to do today is demystify a little bit, first of all, what mindset really is, what it's all about. And secondly, the three things you only get to look at, three things that are going to help you move from feeling like it's an otherworldly, ethereal, woo-woo thing up there to seeing it as something that is not only actionable, but helpful in order to move forward and to do the things that you were created to do. So when we're talking about mindset, what we are really talking about is managing the processes that go on inside our brain and inside our mind that translate into the actions that we take and the results that we experience, right? So Brooke Castillo has this framework where she walks people through CTFAR. I think I got it right. CTAFR, which means you have a circumstance, right? Circumstances lead to a certain thought. That thought leads to a feeling. The feeling leads to an action, and the action leads to a result, right? And that's what we're talking about when we're talking about mindset. We're talking about that series of things that happen at a subconscious level most of the time that we're not fully aware of most of the time, and that end up being responsible for most of the results we experience, right? And so when it boils down to it, mindset is about how do we take charge of our beliefs, our thoughts, and in turn, our feelings in order to be able to lead ourselves or move ourselves to the actions that will lead to the results that we're looking for, right? So far, so good. So mindset is this set of processes that take place in the brain. And specifically, mindset is about managing those processes so that instead of them controlling us and the results that we get, we have more of a controlling power, more of a responsibility stance, more of an ownership of what happens inside of there and the results that we get. Right? So it's kind of like flipping it from going on automatic and letting your brain run your life to actually being responsible for what you're doing and why you're doing it and managing what is in front of you so that you can get the results that you want. I hope that makes sense. If you have questions, add them in the comments. So when it comes to those things, there's really three main things that we get to focus on in order to advance our mindset and in order to move out of letting our mind run the show and into being more in control of the things we do, why we do them, and the results we get because of what we do. Ready? So I am going to bring all of this down to the most actionable, most tangible elements possible. All right. And the first thing that we get to talk about in terms of mindset and actually operating from a mindset that is supportive of what we want to do and accomplish in this world is the element of identity. See, I've said this before and I will say it again 1.5 million times. We don't do what we want or even what we know we should do. We do who we are. If at any point we operate outside of the identity that we have accepted as ours, the way we see ourselves, who we see ourselves as being, then processes are going to start taking place in the brain that are going to force you to get back in alignment with or in compliance with that identity that you identify with and that you have adopted for yourself. All right. So it's kind of like when you set a thermostat, and this is the example I use most of the time, you set a thermostat to a certain temperature, let's say 75 degrees. If it gets cooler than 75 degrees, then the heater will kick on and the temperature will rise back up to 75. If it gets hotter than 75 degrees, then the AC will kick on and it will cool it down right back to 75, but it will keep it right there, right? So the way our brain operates is the thermostat based on that identity. However we see ourselves, our brain is going to subconsciously have us do things that are going to take us back to that identity, to match that identity. So if, for example, when I was trying to lose weight, I saw myself as a heavy girl. And that was a big part of the problem. I always saw myself as a heavy girl. Even when I was a baby, even when I was little, I saw myself as a heavy girl. So when I started to lose weight, my brain would be like, wait, that's not you. You're not a skinny mini. You are not someone who is meant to wear designer jeans. And no, you're not that. You are a heavy girl. So it would force me to self-sabotage and to do the things that I knew consciously were not going to help me. And then I would kick myself and get back on the cycle, right, of losing weight and gaining weight because my internal thermostat was set to heavy girl. So the very first thing I had to do in order to lose the weight and keep it off was figure out how do I change the way I see myself from seeing myself as a heavy girl to seeing myself as a fit person who loves working out and who loves eating healthy, right? So here is the actionable part. First of all, stop and ask yourself for a minute, this thing that I've been trying to do, this thing that I'm trying to accomplish, this goal that I have, how does it match how I see myself right now? And if you take just a second to think about it, okay, I want to be a business owner. I had this issue when I started becoming a business owner too, and I've talked about that in other episodes, but I want to be a business owner, right? But I see myself as a teacher who makes $60,000 a year. Then I need to see how those two match if they do at all or if they don't, right? I want to be in business because I don't want to live paycheck to paycheck. And as a teacher, I did. I want to be a business owner because I want more time with my family and more freedom to do the things that I want to do. And as a teacher, I didn't. Somebody else controlled my time for the most part, right? And I started seeing all these discrepancies and I started seeing all the ways in which looking at myself as a heavy girl and trying to lose weight didn't match, or seeing myself as a teacher and trying to make more than $60,000 a year didn't match, right? So the very first thing is recognizing where the conflict is. And the second thing is deciding who you get to be in order to have what you want to accomplish match that identity that you want to be, right? So in my case, and I already mentioned it, when I wanted to lose the weight, I needed to be someone who enjoyed exercising, who loved being fit, and who enjoyed eating sensibly and eating well. Those were the three things. So here's what I did, and here's what I suggest all my clients do, and here's how we start making the shift. Think about that person that you want to be, and think about the three main character traits that that person should and must have in order to achieve the goal that you're looking for, right? So in my case, again, it was fit, eats well, loves working out, right? Fit, eats well, loves working out. In the case of the business, I needed to see myself as someone who can be authoritative, not authoritative, be an authority, right? Be an authority be generous, and be confident. So authority, generosity, and confidence, right? And once you identify the three things that you get to be in order to advance to that process, then I'm going to invite you to do something that I adapted from a mentor I had called Shanda Sumter. So you're going to create a contract with yourself. You're going to create a contract with yourself. And that contract sounds something like this. I am a confident, authoritative, generous leader. Or I am a fit person who loves eating well and loves working out, right? And you can frame it however you want, but you are going to start it with I am. You're going to give yourself an adjective like woman, person, leader. You're going to give yourself an a noun, right? What you're calling yourself. And then you're going to give yourself three adjectives that align with and support the person you want to be, the goal that you're working towards. Now that contract becomes two things. It becomes a filter and it becomes your reminder of who you are, right? So when you're making decisions and you're trying to figure out what do I want to do about this? Okay, would a confident, authoritative, generous woman do that, or leader do that? Would someone who loves working out, who is fit, who loves eating sensibly do that? Yes or no? And that's your filter, right? And the other way it works is once you start feeling a certain way or experiencing a certain emotion or looking at something where you're like, I can't do that, or that doesn't work, or I'm about to backslide, or something is about to happen that doesn't match that new identity, you go, no, wait. I am a confident, generous woman who has authority, and I know I can do this because I am these things, right? You can use this contract as a sort of affirmation or mantra to help you through your day. So you can recite it first thing in the morning. You can recite it throughout your day, anytime you need it. But once you have this contract, it becomes both your filter and what helps you move forward. It propels you. It helps you get out of those spaces when you're acting in a way that is contrary to the new identity that you're becoming, right? So that's the first thing, is your identity. Who do you want to be? And what does that look like? And create a contract with yourself to act in the way that that person would act and will act, right? The second thing is, how do you talk to yourself? How do you talk to yourself? So we talk a lot about reframing in the personal development and professional development arena. We talk a lot about taking those thoughts or those beliefs, those limiting beliefs, and turning them into something that is more empowering and more supportive of your goals and of your dreams of what you want to do. And I believe that there's some good in that. The problem is, first of all, in order to do that, you have to take the time to identify your limiting beliefs, which will get you down a spiral if you're not careful, that will keep you spinning your wheels for a long time. The second thing about that is, in the reframing process, they don't really explain to us really well how to do that. So most of us end up going to another extreme. So what I love to do is just focus on self-talk, on how do we talk to ourselves? Because once we learn how to talk to ourselves, we're going to automatically battle those limiting beliefs. We're going to automatically shift and change the verbiage we use with ourselves and the things we tell ourselves. And we're going to automatically shift how we perceive certain things and how we process certain things, because it's all done with language, right? So in your self-talk, I invite you to focus mostly on the questions you ask yourself. The questions you ask yourself most of the time, and we don't notice this most of the time, but for most of us, a lot of the conversations we have with ourselves happen in the form of questions. So what day is it? What am I wearing today? What do I have on my agenda for today? What am I going to have for breakfast? And then, why did I do that? Why am I so dumb? How did I let this happen? Why is it that these things always happen to me, right? So most of the time we talk to ourselves in questions, and our thoughts are actually the answers we give ourselves to those questions. So it stands to reason that if we ask ourselves better, more empowering questions, we will give ourselves better answers, and therefore we will experience better results. So two questions that I love and that I invite you to test are, how else can I see this? And what else could this mean? How else can I see this? And what else could this mean? Whenever something happens where you catch yourself going, oh, why do these things always happen to me? Wait, wait, wait. How else can I see this? What else could this mean? And it will shift how you use your imagination and your mind in order to move you and propel you forward towards the things that you know that you are meant to have. And then finally, we get to look at our decisions. We get to look at the decisions we make and how we make them, right? So when we are making decisions, the important thing to understand is that most of the time we resist decisions because they feel like they are shackles almost. Like once we make a decision, we're bound to it, we're tied to it, and there's nothing we can do to get out of it. So when we start understanding that decisions are really just tests, that decisions are really just things we're trying out for now, and that nothing we decide is unchangeable or set in stone. Like the only thing we cannot change is death, right? And that's not a decision we're going to make. So when we are looking at all these other decisions, the only thing we cannot revert, the only thing we cannot fix is actually death. Everything else we can revert and we can change. So the decisions we're making are really tests. And when we shift that perspective and when we start thinking, okay, I need to make this decision. First of all, I'm going to run it through my filter of my contract, right? Secondly, I'm going to see what questions I'm asking myself around this process, around this decision I get to make. And lastly, I'm going to run down all my options and pick one, knowing that this is a test that I'm going to try and see all the evidence that I can gather that this is the best option. Right? So I'm not going into this test trying to prove myself wrong. I'm going into this test looking for evidence to prove myself right. Yes. Andy Andrews said that God did not give us the ability to always make right decisions, but he did give us the ability to make a decision and then make it right. And that's what this process is about, right? If you have a decision you get to make and you run it through the filter of who you are, right? Who you are now, who you are being, and through your contract. And then you start thinking about, okay, what questions am I asking myself about this? And then think, okay, if I'm looking at this from the right perspective, and I'm looking at this as this generous, creative, whatever person you decided you are in your contract, then I have these options left. Out of these options, which are not feasible, which I have tried before and didn't work, or which I don't feel like I have the resources right now to get it done. And if you question anything about resources, remember, go to IG marcy.amaro and send me a DM with the word crops so you can get the crops inventory. But anyway, I digress. When you have your few options left, then all those options are equally good. Just pick one and then get to work improving and finding evidence that that is the best one. Okay. So for example, when I wanted to lose weight, I knew I needed to move. Yes. I've been asthmatic my whole life. So I knew I wasn't going to run and I knew I wasn't going to do anything that would exacerbate my asthma. So I started looking at all the options and I started thinking, okay, if I do this and this and this and this and this, blah, 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 blah. Finally, I said, you know what? I'm going to test rollerblading. And I loved it. And I could do it without exacerbating my asthma. And I could do all these things. But I went into it thinking, you know what? I'm going to prove to myself that I can do this. I'm going to find all the different ways in which I can become a great rollerblader, right? And then I said, okay, I can find my friends and I can go with my friends. I can take it slow. I can take it a little bit at a time and then continue to build my stamina. And I did all of the things that I knew I needed to do in order to prove myself right, that I could rollerblade and that that was the way for me to add movement to my life. So whatever decision it is that you're trying to make, approach it that way. This is the test I'm going to do right now. This is the theory I'm going to test right now. And these are the ways in which I'm going to prove myself right and go to work and finding that evidence that proves that you are actually right in that theory. And give yourself a time frame, right? Like, I'm going to test this for 6 months. I'm not going to go back and forth every other week. I'm not going to second guess this thing and keep switching out what I'm testing every month. I'm going to keep on this one thing for at least 6 months. And then at the end of 6 months, you go back and you look at it and you're like, okay, I gave it my best shot because I'm proving myself right, but still I'm not getting the results that I want. So let's go back to the drawing board and see which of the other options I'm testing next. And you keep doing that until you get to the one that actually works. Makes sense? But when it comes to your mindset, what you're doing really is managing the two or three main things that can derail the way your brain is processing what it is that you're trying to do that is new and that runs the risk of proving that you have a different identity or that something is contrary to what your brain has believed. Make sense? I hope this has been helpful. And so go back and think about, who do you get to be? Think about the questions you're asking yourself and think about what you are going to test, what decision you're going to make that you're going to test and prove yourself right in. And let me know how that goes. And in the meantime, go to Instagram, connect with me, follow me. I add so many tips and so many ideas on there. Plus, you can just DM me the word crops and I will send you the link to that resource that is completely free and that is going to help you move from doubt into action, from doubting into doing. So, IG, Marcy.Amaro, and I will see you next time here on Sincerely Speaking. Thank you.